Well, hello and welcome to the channel. Welcome to Shaun Spins. I'm your host, Shaun. Now, this channel is all about music and reviewing different records. I dedicate the channel to my father. It was his idea for me to start a channel talking about music. Lately, I've been making videos about art lessons for my students, so this is going to be a little different. Now, episode one, we're going to review this Nirvana Live at Paramount. This came out about a year or so ago. I particularly have the more rarer, I've come to find out now, orange vinyl that I ordered from the Nirvana website. Now, before we get to the record, let's get to the history of me and the Paramount concert. First time I ever heard anything from the Paramount concert was this CD single. Now, I collect a lot of Nirvana stuff. I particularly like the CD singles because it had a lot more of Cobain's artwork. Now, this particular one had part of the Paramount performance on it, particularly Drain You. Now, Drain You is my favorite Nirvana song, and also one of Kurt's favorite songs that remained in the set forever. I like that song so much, it's actually tattooed right there on my arm. There is the musical notes for Drain You. Now, you might be saying to yourself, well, what about if I have the 45 record? Drain You's not on there. Only Come As You Are and Endless Nameless. But the interesting thing about this single and this single, this is the only time I ever actually heard the recorded of Endless Nameless. My copy of Nirvana's Nevermind is one of the early copies that actually does not have the secret track on it. It just ends after Something in the Way. There is no break and all of a sudden Endless Nameless starts. So when I used to hear people talk about Endless Nameless at the end of Nevermind, I had no idea what they were talking about. Well, let's go on to the next single that had a little bit of Paramount, which is this one. Now, as I said earlier, I particularly like these singles because of Kurt's artwork on them. And growing up, I thought this was great to see his artwork. Being an artist and a would-be guitar player at the time, it made my day. Now, this one has Been a Son on it from Paramount. Also has an early photo of Francis Bean. Now, another big thing about this CD single, for us growing up in the 90s, it has the lyrics to Nevermind. So a lot of us at that time had no idea what Kurt was saying. So to get a copy of the lyrics was incredible. Now, I know you might be saying, well, why couldn't you just go on the web? Internet was very, very simple at the time. Didn't have any of that. So to get a copy of this, woo-woo. And when I was growing up, it was a lot easier to find cassette tape singles than it was to find the CD singles. You know, as this one says, they came from out of the country, a lot of these. I actually like Curmudgeon the best on this. So those are the first two times I heard the Paramount concerts. And the only other time we got to hear a live version of Nirvana was after Kurt passed that we got from the Muddy Banks. Now, that was just a mix-up of a lot of different things together, and it wasn't a pure concert from start to finish. Now, you got to remember, there was no concerts on YouTube. It didn't exist. And the only way you got to hear Nirvana, if you didn't get to see them live, was bootlegs. Now, during the time of Nevermind, a music video used parts of the Paramount show, but it wasn't the Paramount show. And they used part of 1991, the year punk broke. So, when Live Tonight Sold Out came out, then we got to see part of the Paramount performance. Now, this is it on DVD. However, this is my original VHS copy. And I gotta tell you, I actually prefer the VHS copy. I used to carry that copy everywhere with me. Be at a friend's house, it'd be in my book bag. I got something we can watch right here, and I'd pull out that tape. So this is the first time we actually got to see part of the Paramount concert, particularly Endless Nameless. Now you have to remember, for me, Endless Nameless was kind of a strange song. I knew nothing of it. During this footage, we got to see Kurt with his Fernandez neck Stratocaster, and we really got to see how much he could smash a guitar. Now, years and years later, the 20th anniversary box set of Nevermind came out. And one of the big reasons I wanted to get it was the Butch Vig mixes of Nevermind, taking Andy Wallace out, and also a full version of the Paramount concert, not only as a CD, but as a DVD. Now, my box still has the sticker on the box listing all this. So this is the first time not only did I get to hear the entire concert, I got to see it also. Now, this concert is meant a lot to me. The particular time it happened was on Halloween of 1991, and shortly after Nevermind came out. And Kurt was particularly seemed happy to play these songs. You know, later on in his career, you know, Smells Like Teen Spirit was not a song he wanted to play. Now, the set also contains a lot of the earlier Sub Pop stuff in it. Later on in the career, you might only have heard two songs from Sub Pop, but this particular performance has a lot, and it's played in front of a home audience. Let's start breaking down the vinyl record. Now, as I stated earlier, I had a copy of it on CD for a few years because of the anniversary of Nevermind. So to get it on record, you know, I've heard it, but I still wanted to get it on record. Now, I particularly bought it from the Nirvana site because they had it in the orange, and I believe it was the same price as the black vinyl issue of it. I am usually not a person that goes out of my way to buy records for certain colors. The only time I ever done that was with a cassette tape for Dinosaur Jr. They issued Bug in a limited number of cassettes. I think it was 250 or 500, and I rushed to a Dinosaur Jr. show just to get a copy. Now, this record does come as a gatefold that opens. It's got some great pictures inside, a ticket and a backstage pass. I love the original ticket, and I wonder what this entire show would be like. They should definitely issue a deluxe with Nirvana, Mudhoney, and Bikini Kill. Great show. Back of it's got the track listings and a few more pictures. Two record set, very thick vinyl. It comes with, it seems to be a little sticker. It's got an interesting texture to it. On the back of it is the redeem code for the formats to get a digital download. And it also comes with this little poster. Two-sided. This would have been a whole lot sweeter if it was times four, like the old school records used to have, like the old Bob Dylan poster. Would have been a whole lot sweeter. Now, this is mixed, completely different than the CD single of Drain You. That was completely done by Andy Wallace. This is done by, well, it mentions Andy Wallace, but then it's got a whole other team here. Well, now we'll talk about which one I prefer. Now, to tell you the truth, I prefer the CD single. As much as I thought Andy Wallace kind of did a number to Nevermind, I thought his version of the live thing was a little bit more stripped down. The anniversary one definitely has more bass and it's loud. The drums are loud. The record to me is kind of in the middle, even though I believe they claim it's the same mix. I don't think so though, because it lists the one same gentleman on both. But it just seems a little, the record seems a little bit not as loud. The bass is not as loud. I often wonder what Kurt would have thought of the mix, if he would have preferred the Andy Wallace or the one that's a little louder with the bass and the drums and stuff. I'll tell you, it would have been really neat if they did a deluxe version that Steve Albini remixed. Now, that would have been interesting. Would have been a whole lot like Tad's Salt Lick album. Now, I know Steve Albini had nothing to do with the Nevermind production, but that would have been pretty interesting. I would love to see and hear a Steve Albini remix of Nevermind 2. Because Kurt Cobain's music in my world has nothing to do with double track guitars and double track vocals and reverb and all this stuff. It should just be completely stripped down. Well, let's take a listen a little bit. One baby, two. So to me, the vinyl live at Paramount is a little bit lower than the 20th anniversary when it comes to the mix. It's not as loud, and it seems like the bass is a little bit less in the mix. I prefer hearing more of Kurt, you know, stepping on that DS1 or possibly a DS2 distortion pedal. So I like hearing him more in the mix. I don't know if that's because I'm a guitar player. Possibly. Now, it is a great concert. Is it worth getting on orange vinyl? Yeah, I don't know. If the difference of $100, I would probably get it on black vinyl. But when I got it, I think they were both the same price. The concert is just a great time in the history of Nirvana. Like I said earlier, Kurt was excited to play these songs. And he's in front of a home crowd. It's got a lot of energy to it, similar to early Ramones shows that just keep going, like the Ramones at the Rainbow. Well, I hope you enjoyed this first episode, and keep listening to music and enjoy it.